Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Christ Lutheran Vail Church. I'm Pastor Hook, and this is Josh. CLV is streaming our worship service this morning, and we are so excited and happy to be with you all today.
Don't forget to follow our Facebook page, Christ Lutheran Vail Church, and subscribe to the YouTube channel. Both have tons of great content to help you with your walk with God. You can also follow us on Instagram, at CLV Church, for another way to stay connected during the week.
Now, if you're new to us, we'd love to connect with you a little bit better. You can text the word welcome to our church phone number displaying on the screen right now, and we'll send you a few texts to tell you about our church, and hopefully we'll learn more about how we can serve you.
Today we continue our series about the new normal. When life thrusts a new normal on us, we can get fearful, lonely, and depressed. Today's story looks at a young woman named Ruth who loses all hope for the future. When her husband dies, she is crushed and alone. But as she starts living her new normal, God provides glimmers of hope. And most importantly, he never leaves her.
That is so true. With God, we always have a bright future. But first, we're going to worship God with some praise and some singing. And as we get started focusing our attention on God, why don't you just take a minute to greet one another in the comments, and then we'll get ready to sing.
The name. Till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Today we are talking about living in the new normal. At Christ Lutheran Vale, we celebrate everyone who finds the love of Jesus, particularly in these times of change. If you have given to CLV, you are our partner in forwarding our mission, making loving disciples. Through programs like the Helping Hands Fund, where we provide food and short-term assistance to those who have emergency needs, we show the love of Jesus by letting Him use our hands and feet to serve our community. Our goal is to show our neighbors, loved ones, and friends Christ's deep and unending love in this world. Whether you have given before or would like to do so for the first time, you can invest in our mission by going to ChristLutheranVale.org and clicking on I Want to Give at the top right of the page. You'll have a chance right now to do that if you would like. Thank you so much for helping us to bring Christ's joy and love to our community. And now, Pastor Hook has a message for us. He's going to talk about what God says when we are faced with a new normal.
So, do we have a president yet? Now, this may seem like a strange question because you are watching this on Sunday morning, and it is quite possible that by Sunday morning we've answered this question. But when I record these sermons for online Sunday, I actually do them earlier in the week. And so right now it's Thursday morning, and we still do not know yet who the next president of the United States is going to be. Now, I know that some of you, if you found out the results, or when you find out the results, some of you are going to be absolutely elated about who's going to be the president. And some of you are going to be absolutely devastated as to who's going to be the president. It seems like in American politics, it seems like it's almost like a football game. We want our side to win and we root for our side. And when our side loses, you know, we say, well, that's too bad, you know, better luck next time. But there are many people in our society today, and it could be you, or it could be people that you love or that you live with, that if their candidate does not win, or if their issues do not win, or if things do not go well for them, they will be devastated. They'll be angry, they'll be upset, they'll mope around, and things will not go well for them for a while. Now, this is a perfect segue into what I want to talk to you about today. We are in this sermon series, this message series about a new normal, navigating the road ahead. And last week we looked at the story of Joshua and how he was grieving over Moses, but then he crossed over the Jordan and God helped him with his grief, and how a new normal can be very difficult and there is grieving for all of us, but that God helps us to cross the Jordan and move into a new normal. Today I want to take a look at a different story, because there are times when challenges or things hit our life and we grieve about it, but for some reason we never get over it. It's like if you've ever seen a stream of water, the stream of water goes down the river or down the stream, and it flows and our life flows. But there's sometimes when that water meets a mud hole or ends up at a hole somewhere and it gets rancid and it gets stinky and it gets horrible and it doesn't move forward. It just stays there and gets sour. And you don't want to drink it and you don't even want to be around it. And that's when our life turns south. That's when we go around this spiral of anger and resentment, and we just can't move forward from it. And that's what I want to talk about today, because in order to have a new normal in our life, in order to navigate the road ahead, it's helpful for us to understand that there are times in our life when it gets really bad, and how do we move forward from that? And so today I'm going to take a look at a story. It's the Old Testament story of Ruth. You may have heard the Old Testament story of Ruth. You may have even gone through the Old Testament story of Ruth. This story takes place in the time of the judges. Last week we looked at Joshua going into the Promised Land. And when he went into the Promised Land, they had judges that kind of ruled the land until they got their first king, King Saul. But in that period of time, between Joshua and King Saul, they had judges, and this story takes place at that point. It's the time of the judges. And it's a story of a man, and his name is Elimelech. And Elimelech is actually living in Bethlehem, same place as David. And he's living in Bethlehem when a famine comes. And the famine is so bad that he decides he's going to move his family from Bethlehem across the Dead Sea into a land called Moab. So this man, Elimelech, takes his wife, Naomi, and his two boys, and they travel the 100, 150 miles or so around the Dead Sea into the land of Moab. This is a land that's kind of far away, but it's not too far away. And it's quite a journey, but he's able to get there. And when he gets there, he finds food, he finds water, and apparently he finds a pretty decent life, because he actually stays there for quite a long time. His two boys, well, they get married. They both marry Moabite women, and life seems to be going really well for Naomi and Elimelech and the two boys and their two wives. There's no children yet in either of those marriages, but life seems to be going pretty well. Until life doesn't go so well. Elimelech dies. So now Naomi only has her two boys and her two daughter-in-laws until they also die. And it's a horrible, tragic situation, because without any males around, there just isn't a lot of hope for that family. That's the way it was back at that time. So Naomi goes to her two daughters and she says, listen, there's nothing left for me here. You are living here in the land of Moab. You're still young. You can still produce children. Life can go on for you. So I suggest that you stay here in Moab, but I'm going to go back to Bethlehem. I'm going to go back to some familiar surroundings, and I'm just going to go back there. Well, one of the daughters takes her up on that and says, okay, have a good time. It was nice knowing you. She stays in Moab. But the other daughter is named Ruth. And Ruth decides to accompany Naomi back to Bethlehem, because Naomi and Ruth have an incredibly strong, powerful relationship of love that wasn't torn apart by the death of Ruth's husband, by the death of Ruth's husband's brother, and by the death of her father-in-law. She still had an incredibly strong relationship with Naomi, and she decides to stay with Naomi. And if you look at the book of Ruth, if you've ever studied the book of Ruth, that relationship of love is an incredibly strong story, and it covers the rest of the book of Ruth. But I'm not looking at Ruth today. Today I want to look at Naomi, because the story of Naomi helps us to understand about this time in our life where we are so angry and bitter and upset and mope around that we can't move forward. And I think by looking at Naomi's story, it'll help us understand what we can do in those times when those things happen in our own lives. So that's really where we're going to start. And we're going to go to Ruth, the book of Ruth, chapter 1, and we're going to start in verse 19. This is where we pick up the story. So the two women, this is Naomi and Ruth, went on until they came to Bethlehem. And when they arrived in Bethlehem, the whole town was stirred because of them. And the women exclaimed, "Can this be Naomi?" Now, you can understand that they hadn't seen Naomi in quite a long time, but here she comes right over the hill into Bethlehem, and the people are amazed that Naomi is back in Bethlehem with another woman. And so they ask, is this Naomi? But I want you to listen to what Naomi says. We begin in verse 20. She says, "Don't call me Naomi," she told them. "Call me Mara. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi?" Now, this word Mara is a Hebrew word, and it is a word that truly means just bitter or bitterness. And when Naomi comes back into the village, they said, "Is this Naomi? Is this the one that left many, many years ago and now she's returned? No, Naomi, it's good to see you." And you can almost hear the sadness and the bitterness in Naomi's voice when she says, "Don't call me Naomi." She said, "Call me bitter. Call me Mara. Because I went away full and happy and love and joy, and we were able to survive the famine. But now I've lost everything, and I just don't see any future. And you can call me bitter. You can call me cursed. You can call me Mara." You see, here's what I see in this phrase. I'm no longer the person I was. My life is no longer living. I've had this terrible tragedy happen in my life, and I can no longer find happiness and joy and peace in this world. In effect, I am bitter. Now, we talked about this list last week, about how when things happen in our life that are devastating or tragic, we should grieve, and we should hold on to God when we're grieving, and knowing that He's holding on to us and He's carrying us through the grief. That's all perfectly natural. But at some point, you have to cross the Jordan. At some point, you realize that God puts you down in your grief and you move forward in your life. But there are times in our life when things happen, for whatever reason, where we just cannot move on. We see our life as a tragedy that cannot be repaired, and we are bitter. Now, at Christ Lutheran Vale, we know that in tragedy, when God is carrying you through a tragedy, what He's really doing is He's expanding your root system. He's expanding your faith. He's helping you grow in your relationship with Him. He's helping you to see that through this tragedy, I have grown closer to God. I've become more compassionate or empathetic. My root system has grown. I've learned from this. I have more wisdom. I am deeper. I'm a person who can take this tragedy, no matter how difficult, and see how God can use this tragedy where I can still be His hands and feet in the world around me. And then you'll have other people that simply cannot move on from the tragedy. They see the tragedy is so severe and so horrible that their life basically is over. And if their life is over, they're going to become bitter. And by being bitter, they're going to take as many people down with them as they possibly can. Now that truly is bitterness. And that's what I read into this story of Naomi. She comes into Bethlehem and people look at her and she says, "Don't call me Naomi. Just call me bitter. Call me Mara." Have you ever met people like this? Have you ever been like this? Have you ever been or seen people that are just so upset with the way that life has gone that they just can't move forward? In many instances, we see life as a card game, right? And in a card game, right, you get a set of cards and you play the best you can with the cards that you've been given. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. But the great thing is that you know that you're going to get another hand. You can play again. But in life, it doesn't work that way. In life, you're dealt like a hand. And the whole purpose of life is to try to get the best you can out of the hand that you've been dealt. Because you only get one hand, right? That's it. And sometimes the hand that is dealt to you can be devastating, can be horrible. It can really force you to look inward and upward and outward to try to figure out how to move forward with this hand that I've been dealt. There was a German philosopher, I'm sure you've heard of him, Friedrich Nietzsche, and he said, "That which doesn't kill us makes us stronger." And I actually believe that there's some truth in that, that sometimes the things that are dealt in our hands, when we get through them, we are stronger. But there are other times where it doesn't make us stronger. It actually kind of kills us. We have no hope for the future. We have no joy. We're in this time of bitterness, and we spiral downward and downward and downward until we are a cesspool of yuck that nobody wants to be around, that nobody can help us, because we are so deeply focused on our own condition that we are not able to be helped in this situation. And that's really where I see Naomi. Now, maybe I'm reading more into this than I should be, but when I think about people that I've encountered in my life that are in this bitter state, that's what this reminds me of. Now, when you're in this bitter state, there are actually, in my opinion, three things that are kind of common to everybody that are in this bitter state. And the first one is this: the future is bleak. The future is bleak. Because bitterness is hopelessness. They look at their life, people in this situation, when I've been in this situation, and we look at our high school, and it's hopeless. This situation will never get better. The future is horrible. We see how things are today,
in our life, in our bitterness, and we are so focused on that, we can't see that there could be any future that's anything other than bleak. I've seen this. People who are perhaps nearing death, they're at the end of their life. And I've actually had some people in my family say this, but you talk to them and, you know, they might be in pain, or they might even be in the hospital, or might be in a long-term condition. But they just keep saying, "Lord, take me now, Lord, take me now." And of course we say, "No, we don't want the Lord to take you now." But they don't see any way that they can move beyond the situation that they're in. And yet they still have life to live. They can still be the hands and feet of God, and they can still have relationships with other people. There's still a lot of joy that can be accomplished. And yet they just want to turn over and die. They just want to die. I'm sure you've met people like that. I once remember talking to a woman who was in pain and cancer. And the doctor said, "Hey, you might be able to try this medical marijuana." That was on the ballot, wasn't it? "Medical marijuana, it might help you in the pain." And she's like, "Nope, not going to have it, not going to do it, because that's just not who I want to be. I would rather live in pain than try something that might alleviate the pain." So that is one common thing that I see in people that are just wallowing in bitterness. They say the future is bleak. The second is this. They say, "I have nothing to be thankful for." Bitterness is not focusing on what is good in this world, but basically bitterness is focusing on everything that's going wrong in the world, and especially what's going on in our life that is so tragic or so horrible. And when they do that, when they focus inward on their own life, they can't see anything that they could be thankful for. They have nothing to be thankful for. And it is so easy in the human condition to look at all the blessings and the joy that everybody else has and look at your own life and say, I have nothing to be thankful for, and so I am just angry and bitter and inward focused. I have nothing to be thankful for. That's all they see. I remember one time we bought a brand new minivan when we were living in Denver. We bought it from John Elway, who actually did not come out and hand us the keys to the car. Actually, we never saw the guy at all. He wasn't even on the site when we bought the car. But we like John Elway, so we bought a John Elway dealership. We bought a minivan, brand new, first brand new car we'd bought. And we're so excited and happy about it. And then it got a scratch on it. It was a little scratch. Most people would never see the scratch, but I saw it. And every time I looked at that minivan, I saw the scratch. Now, it was a brand new minivan. The engine was good. The exterior was good. The interior was good, of course, for a while, until, you know, the kids destroyed it. But for a brief period of time, every time I looked at the outside of that car, I could not help but see the scratch that was on the outside of that car. And that's the same way when we're bitter, right? You can have so much going on that's good in your life, that there's hope and joy and love in your life, but you focus on that one thing that just irritates you, that you can't get over, and you're bitter about it. And you say, "I have nothing to be thankful for, nothing." And it's really focusing on all the negative things going on and not the positive things that are going on. And then the third thing I see common, besides that the future is bleak and I have nothing to be thankful for, is this: I'm going to put happiness on hold until certain things happen. I'm going to put happiness on hold until certain things happen. And you've met this. We actually have all done this, right? I'm not going to truly be happy until I finish school, right? I'm not truly going to be happy until I get married. I'm not truly going to be happy until I get a job, that great job that I really, really like, and then I'm going to be happy. Or I'm not going to be happy until I have a house or a place to live that I like, that's in a neighborhood that I like. I'm not going to be happy until I have grandkids. I'm not going to be happy until I get this or that. I remember working once at a very, very large organization, and there were many people at this organization who were probably in their late 50s, early 60s, and they were saying, just, "I'm not going to be happy until I retire." And they would sit there. They'd come into work every day, and they would look at the clock, and they were just waiting until retirement could happen. Because once retirement happens, then I can truly be happy. Once these things in my life happen, then I can truly be happy. And I remember just feeling this deep sense of sadness, because this was the prime of their life. I mean, this was a time in their life where they had so much to share in the company, and they could do so much. I mean, the wisdom, imagine somebody in their late 50s or early 60s that have, you know, the wisdom that they have in any organization. And yet they didn't want to focus on that. They just wanted to focus on, well, maybe my life will get better once I retire. My friends, all of these things lead to bitterness. All these things are opportunities in our life to let the focus on ourselves just take us down a bitter, bitter path. Now, you may think that this can only happen in deep tragedies in your life, but these can actually happen at any tragedy in your life. It can happen with a loss of a job. It can happen when the future that you're hoping happens doesn't really materialize. It can happen in many, many, many times in your life. I'll just point this out. It's not even in here, but reminded me of it. When I was in my 30s, I thought I had a really good job, and I was married and I had kids, but there was a period in my time when I was just deeply saddened. And I think the sadness was that that I figured by the time I was 30 that life would look a lot different than it did. And it was just, I wouldn't say it was drudgery, but there was just so much overwhelming stuff in my life that took up so much of my time and so much of the energy. And, you know, this is common with a lot of people that have, you know, that have kids. It's just so overwhelming that you don't even get a chance to work on some of the things in your hopes and dreams. And so you kind of put them on hold. And I think after a while, it just kind of gets to you. And it could be a time where you could actually turn the grief and the sadness and loss of that into bitterness. And the horrible thing about bitterness is that once it starts to spiral, first slowly and then spirals more and more until you get to a point where you can't get out of it. Bitterness can destroy a life. So my recommendation is don't become bitter. Well, how do you not become bitter? Well, let's take a look at Naomi. Because actually, I think what she does is very helpful. And maybe it provides a lesson to some of the things that we could do to help prevent us becoming bitter for the rest of our lives for the things that happen. So the first thing that we see in Naomi is what she does. We read this earlier, but she decides in verse 19, "So the two women went on until they came to Bethlehem. And when they arrived at Bethlehem, the people saw them in Bethlehem." So the first thing that we can do that can help us is to reach back to those things that are familiar. Reach back to those things that helped us find joy previously. Now for Naomi, I'm sure she looked at her life and she said, "You know, when my husband and I were first married, we were living in Bethlehem, we were surrounded by people that loved us, we were doing things, you know, it was the famine that caused us to Moab, and maybe one of the things that can help me out of my bitterness is to go back to Bethlehem, go back to where it's familiar." And so she does. Counselors actually do this all the time. If you've ever gone to a counseling session, one of the things that they may encourage you to do is to think back at a moment in your time where you actually were able to overcome grief or sadness, or how did you find joy, or you had a situation happen in your life. How did you deal with that situation before? And sometimes it is helpful to look back and say, when was I happy? When did things really go well? And what were the circumstances around that? And can I replicate those circumstances? And so Naomi does that. She looks in her life and she says, when was I truly happy? And she says, well, it was Bethlehem. There's nothing stopping you, Naomi, or any of us, for trying to replicate those circumstances where we were able to overcome the things that we're dealing with right now. If you're grieving with somebody, if you've lost someone, it is okay. It is helpful, actually very healthy, to have discussions with people about the person that you've lost. To explain to them the joy, how it was, and describe that person to another person. That is extremely helpful. If you've lost someone that you love, to just sit back and find someone and just tell them about what that person was like. It's okay to talk. It's actually very, very healthy to talk about that. You know, right now we're in the politics time, and eventually we're going to have a new president, and people are going to get very angry, or they're going to be very happy, and they're going to express it on Facebook. And so maybe now politics isn't the great way to do that. But if you can find somebody who's trusted in your life that you can talk to and say, hey, listen, this is the issue or the candidate that I was really hoping would win, and they didn't. And just talk about it and vent about it. Just be able to talk about it. It's extremely healthy. Reach back to a time that's familiar and talk about it. I'll tell you one thing happened in my life. When I was a kid, I actually did a lot of hiking. My family did a lot of hiking when we were young, and then when I got into high school and college, I did a lot of hiking. And then you get married, and you don't hike as much because you got, you know, kids and dogs and all that sort of thing. And then my son, my youngest, went off to college. And, you know, when your last one goes off to college, those of you that have done this, you get this deep hole in your life. And, of course, I was doing a lot of stuff with the youth, and I was able to, you know, I was still able to connect with them on a certain level. And so we went on a hike together. And as I was hiking with the youth, I realized how much I loved hiking as a kid. And so after that, I decided to hike again, and then again, and then again. And I realized that hiking, for me, was a thing that I could reach back to that was familiar, that just brought me incredible joy and peace. And I've continued to do that. I just find incredible peace and joy by doing hiking. So if you found something in the past that helped you, reach back to something that's familiar. The other thing you can do is reach out to a friend. Now we see this in Ruth and Naomi. Ruth could have stayed in Moab. And the whole great thing about Ruth is that she decides to stay with Naomi and help her through the grief. But because these two women had such a strong relationship together, they were able to get through the grief together. Remember, they both were grieving because they both lost loved ones. And through that friendship, they were able to push through the grief and not become bitter because of a friendship. So if you're going through grief and it turns into bitterness, see if you can find somebody in your life that can kind of help you through that. Because a trusted friend or somebody that you're able to talk to is so helpful. We have a counselor on our site that does counseling. And you know, sometimes counseling, and many, many times, counseling can be very, very helpful. Just to reach out to somebody that will listen patiently and lovingly and let you talk about things. Of course, as a pastor, I do this many times with people in our congregation, even people outside of the congregation. I'm available. We have this great ministry in our congregation called Stephen Ministry, and this is a fantastic program where you take 40 or 50 hours of training to learn how to listen, and that's really all it is. And I found this training to be absolutely beneficial in my whole entire life. It's not just church work. It's being a good manager, being a good person in the community. I mean, listening and the ability to listen to people and understand what it is that they're struggling with, and just to be a trusted friend that can listen and provide honest listening skills for those things. Very, very helpful. So my encouragement is if you're going through bitterness, yes, find something that's familiar. And yes, reach out to a friend. But the third thing that Naomi does, this is so profound, I don't want you to miss it. It's in verse 21. She says, "Why call me Naomi? The Lord has afflicted me. The Almighty has brought misfortune upon me." You see, Naomi understands that this affliction that's come to her truly is blessed by God, or God allows it. Now, she says the Lord caused it. The Lord may or may not have caused it. In the book of Job, he actually does cause grief to Job. But God doesn't purposely bring grief into your life. The grief that comes into our life is because we are created as imperfect human beings. We live in an imperfect world, and so grief is going to happen. But ultimately, God is in relationship with grief. God, he either causes it or he allows it to happen. I mean, the bad things in our life do happen because God allows it to happen. And the third thing that I want you to understand is Naomi picks up on this, is that ultimately all of this goes back to God, because we have a relationship with God. We are his created children, and he is allowing this grief to happen. And there are times in our life when we're bitter, when we turn our back on God and we move away from God. We say, God doesn't exist, or I hate you, God. And then we never go back and lean into God. And what you'll see in the story of Ruth and Naomi is that Naomi leans into God. She never loses the connection with the creator of the universe, ever. And the words that she talks about are just filled with this. The Lord has afflicted me. The Almighty has brought misfortune upon me. Now, you may think that that's a horrible thing to say, but the great thing about that is that Naomi is recognizing that God is still there, that God still exists, and God still loves her. It's just that for right now, God has allowed this affliction to happen in her life. Her theology is correct, because ultimately her affliction is allowed by God. And I don't know, if God purposely did this in her life or allowed it to happen in her life, but I do know that he allows affliction. And when affliction comes, this is a perfect time to either turn it into bitterness, to turn away from God, or to lean into God and let the bitterness be God working through your life. Because there's nothing you can do ever to separate you from his love. And when you're going through tragedy, he is there in the midst of tragedy. And somehow, through the midst of that, he is still working in your life. His spirit is still in your life. His friendship through other people, he is still in your life. And he is never turning away from you. You know, there's a lot of times when bitterness can make us turn away from God, and we get into this deep spiral. But when those happen, he does not turn his back away from you. There's no power on earth that can ever separate you from his love. And so when deep tragedy happens, the best way to get through the bitterness is to simply remember that God does not leave you in your bitterness. Even though you may just turn your back on him and be angry and bitter and upset, he does not turn his back on you. He is always there in your life. And one of the great ways to get through bitterness and not to let it help, to turn you into a very bitter person, is to stay connected with the people that will point out to you over and over again that God still loves you, God still cares for you, God is still in your life, because he still is. Has nothing to do with what we do. It has everything to do with what he did, because he is a God that knew a bitterness. Because he became flesh and he dwelt among us, and the world turned its back on him. And he knows pain, he knows sorrow, he knows hardship. And yet through all of that, he was victorious on Easter Sunday, and he brings his joy and his love and his compassion to your relationship with him. He truly is a God of compassion. I'll close with this. The Apostle Paul, late in his life, gets thrown in prison in Rome. It was a horrible, horrible situation. And he could have been bitter. He could have been angry at God. He could have been angry that he was no longer able to do the things that he wanted to do, that God had called him to do. And you would think a Roman prison would not be a pleasant place. And yet, by every account that we can read, Paul was just okay with it. Yeah, I'm in prison. Okay. Yeah, I'm going to die. Okay. And in the midst of all that, he found ways to be the hands and feet of God to prison guards, to people that he met while he was still in prison, to people that visited him in prison, and the letters that he wrote to prison to various churches. And Paul, by every account, should have had every reason in the world to be bitter, and yet he wasn't. He simply just spread God's love to the world around him in the midst of a horrible situation. My friends, Jesus does not leave us where we are. Jesus leans into us, and Jesus helps us to overcome the bitterness, which is a focus on ourselves, to bring joy and peace, because we focus on the true source of joy and peace. He truly is power, love, and joy. May he help us when we get through those moments where we're so bitter, we don't know how to move forward. Let's pray. Gracious God, we pray for those people in our world, in our country, that are bitter because of the results of elections or because of tragedies that have happened in their life or things that they just don't see how they can move forward. God, you are still with us. You still love us and you still carry us. And for that, we thank you and praise you. Help us in our times when we're tempted with bitterness to fill us with your peace and love and your joy and hold on to us. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Well, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. I did have a few announcements. We are worshiping in person. So if you would like to worship in person, we're doing that at 8:30 and 9:30 at the site. It's been going well. It is a shorter worship service. There's some music. There's a communion time, and then there's a sermon time. And it is a shorter service because we want to be able to clean between the services to make it safe for people who do show up. But I will still be doing this for at least November, December. And so if you do not feel comfortable yet arriving for church on Sunday morning, that's perfectly fine. We are still doing drive-in communion on the first and third Sunday, so you can do that. And you can catch this online. So that's what we're doing. And may God richly bless you this week. We'll meet again next week at the same place. So go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.